Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am going to talk about the module Population and Growth of Cities from Population, Urbanization and Poverty. So students, we are going to discuss about the pattern of growth of different sizes of the cities all across the world. We will also discuss how the growth of the cities has affected the quality of life in terms of education, housing facilities, and other indicators of well-being. This module aims to explain the growth of urban population in various parts of the world, distribution of rural and urban population by major regions of the world, the process of urbanization in various countries, the speed of population growth in cities, the growth of population by age group, the household size and housing demand in urban areas of different regions of the world, the level of human development in different cities of the world, cities and the quality of life of population, and the growth of slum population in various countries. The world is in throes of a sweeping population shift from the countryside to the city. The global urban population is growing by 65 million annually, equivalent to adding 7 new Chicagos or 6 new Parises a year. And for the first time in history, more than half of the world's population is now living in towns and cities. By 2050, 75% of the world population is expected to live in cities, with 95% of that expansion in developing countries. In fact, urban population of developing countries quadrupled from 680 million in 1970 to 2.56 billion in 2010. And this suggests that over the last 40 years, approximately two-thirds of the world population growth had occurred in the area. This explosive growth in world population is thus closely tied to rapid urbanization in developing countries, a trend that is expected to continue. The movement of urban population towards the developing economies and within developing economies, relatively a greater movement towards small-sized cities, has been having its impact upon the demographic features of the world population. In this respect, in this module, we would discuss first the growth of urban population in different regions of the world, and then focus upon change in demographic features of the urban areas over a period of time. Growth of urban population. Between 2011 and 2050, the world population is expected to increase by 2.3 billion, passing from 7 billion to 9.3 billion. At the same time, the population living in urban areas is projected to gain 2.6 billion, passing from 3.6 billion in 2011 to 6.3 billion in 2050. Thus, the urban areas of the world are expected to absorb all the population growth expected over the next four decades, while at the same time drying in some of the rural populations. As a result, the world rural population is projected to start decreasing in about a decade, and there will likely to be 0.3 billion fewer rural inhabitants in 2050 than today. Furthermore, most of the population growth expected in urban areas will be concentrated in the cities and towns of the less developed regions. Asia, in particular, is projected to see its urban population increase by 1.4 billion, Africa by 0.9 billion, and Latin America and the Caribbean by 0.2 billion. Population growth is therefore becoming largely an urban phenomena concentrated in the developing world. The urban population by major geographical area has been shown in Figure 1. The figure shows that of all major geographical areas, Northern America is the most urbanized. 82% of the population lived in urban areas in 2010, up from slightly below 84% in 1950, and it is expected to reach almost 89% by 2050. Next most urbanized region is Latin America, followed by Europe, while Africa and Asia are the best, while Africa and Asia are the least urbanized regions today. In Asia, urbanization has been low in the 1950s. Only 17% lived in urban areas. Today, it is about 44%, a bit more than the level of urbanization of Latin America in the 1950s. By the middle of the century, Asia's population will be about 64% urban. Oceania is the only major region where the level of urbanization has stagnated or even declined since the mid-70s. However, at a high level of more than 70%, it will not change much over the next decades. Africa has still the lowest percentage of urban population, slightly more than 39% in 2010. However, the percentage urban will rapidly increase to about 58% by 2050. The acceleration in urban share of population is due to sustained increase in urban population combined with deceleration of rural population growth. We can observe these changes from Figure 2. The figure shows that with the exception of Africa and Oceania, all major areas are expected to have smaller rural populations in 2050 than today. Today, the majority of rural dwellers live in Asia and Africa, and the concentration of the world rural population in these two major areas combined is expected to increase so that by 2050, 60% of all rural inhabitants are projected to live in Asia and 30% in Africa. The past and future trends of the urban and rural population change are influenced by two components. The first is the overall increase or decline of the national population. The second is the urban population change resulting from the increase or decline of the urban population only. The contribution of each component in the urban population change between 1950 and 2000 and 2000 and 2050 varies markedly among the 10 countries with the largest increase of their future urban population. This can be observed from Figure 3. The figure shows that the increase in the urban population between 1950 and 2000 is equally divided between overall population increase and urban growth in India, Pakistan, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and the Philippines. However, urban population growth played a more important role in the urbanization of China, Nigeria, Indonesia, Bangladesh, and the United Republic of Tanzania. Among these 10 countries, only in the United States, overall population increase has been the main driver of urbanization between 1950 and 2000. However, between 2000 and 2050, urban growth will be the sole driver of the increase in urban population of China. In India, the urban population is expected to increase by 2/3 due to urban growth and 1/3 due to overall population increase. In India, the urban population is expected to increase by 2/3 due to urban growth and 1/3 due to overall population increase. In contrast, the urbanization of the United States until 2050 will be still mainly led by an increase in the overall increase of the population. Realization of these projections is contingent on the continuation of fertility reductions in developing world. If fertility were to remain constant at current levels and the pace of urbanization remained that projected in 2011 revision of world urbanization prospects, the world urban population would increase to 7.4 billion by 2050 instead of the 6.3 billion expected when fertility is assumed to continue declining in all developing regions. In many countries, natural increase, that is the difference of births minus deaths, accounts for 60% or more of the urban population growth. Consequently, policies that facilitate the reduction of fertility by ensuring that couples have access to the modern contraception and that they can decide freely the number of children they desire can contribute to moderate increases in the number of urban dwellers, thereby making it easier for developing countries to adjust to the transformations associated with growing urbanization. Cities and population. A long-term perspective on demographic and economic changes, particularly in the developed world, shows that historically cities have experienced boom and bust cycles over time, and in some places, decline and population contraction result in permanent alterations to city structures. Cities may expand or contract in size and importance. Their growth and decline is dependent on a variety of historical, economic, political, and demographic factors. While some cities are growing more rapidly than others, the widespread assumption that increasing global urbanization means that all cities are growing is false. In fact, evidence shows that in all regions of the world, and especially in the developed regions, many cities are actually shrinking in size. Although slow or negative urban growth is overwhelmingly a developed world phenomena, it is also occurring in developing countries. A UN habitat analysis of 1,408 cities in the developing world showed that 143 cities, or 10.2% of the sample, experienced a reduction in population, that is, it recorded negative growth rates between 1990 and 2000. Here, accelerated growth is defined as growth rate above 4%, rapid rate between 2 to 4%, moderate rate between 1 to 2%, and slow rate is defined as 0 to 1%. The figure shows that rapid or accelerated urban growth is still the norm in most regions of the developing world. However, more than half of the cities in the sample, that is 53%, have been growing at an accelerated or rapid pace since the 1990s. 17% of these cities experienced an accelerated growth rate of more than 4% per year, while 36% saw rapid annual growth rates of between 2 and 4%. However, if we look at the population growth in top 600 cities of the world, surveyed by McKinsey Global Institute, the population in these cities would grow 60% faster than that of the world between 2000 and 2025. It is estimated that as compared to 1% rate of annual growth for world population as a whole, the population of top 600 cities would grow by 1.6% per annum. Interestingly, the proportion of the working age population, that is those aged between 15 to 64 years in these cities, would be declining, but still higher than the world average. The age-wise distribution of population in 600 cities and the world as a whole is shown in figure 5. The world would add 1,351 million people by 2025, out of which 35%, that is 481 million people, would be residing in the top 600 cities. The age-wise growth of population shows that the world would witness highest growth rate of 65 plus population, which would be growing at a rate of 3% per annum as compared to 1.1% per annum for the working age group and 0.2% per annum for the age group less than 15 years. On the other hand, the population in the top 600 cities would be growing at a higher rate for the age groups 15 to 64 years and 65 plus. The growth of population in these age groups would be 1.4% per annum and 4.3% per annum respectively. Thus, the population in the top 600 cities of the world would be aging at a higher speed as compared to the world as a whole. This would lead to a fall in share of working age population in the 600 cities from 71% in 2007 to 69% in 2025, while this share would increase in case of the world as a whole from 65% to 66% during the same time period. Further, it has been estimated that in absolute terms, the cities would add about 310 million to its working age population, 13 million to child population, and about 160 million to 65 plus population. The projections by MGI show that almost whole of the increase in working age population would take place in the cities of the emerging markets. And nearly 2/3 of those would belong to China and South Asia. Household size and housing demand. As the population urbanizes itself, the joint family system converts to dominance of nuclear families, leading to smaller household size but greater demand for housing. This further adds to the pressure of demand for housing and housing amenities. Urbanization is the major reason behind declining size of the households. Those who move are mainly the young adults, and if both of the partners are working, they tend to have smaller families. While the old-aged couples also live alone without their adult children. Globally, it is estimated that the size of the household will decline from 4.4 people per household in 2007 to 3.7 by 2025. Today, the average size of household in the city 600 is already slightly smaller than the global average at 3.2 people, and will drop to a projected 2.7 in 2025. In the cities of developing regions as a whole, it is expected that the average size of households would decline from 3.5 people to 2.9. The regions with the largest estimated decline in the size of their urban households are Sub-Saharan Africa and the Middle East and North Africa. The decline in household size leads to increase in demand for houses. It is expected that between 2007 and 2025, top 600 cities would demand for 250 million additional houses. Half of these new households will be in Chinese cities. Small and mid-size middleweights in the city 600 will drive this surge, contributing an estimated 155 million new households, or more than 20% of global household growth. McKinsey Global Institute finds that the 423 cities in developing regions are likely to be responsible for 85% of the growth in households in the city 600, compared with 15% coming from around 177 cities in developing regions. By 2025, it is projected that almost 50% of the households in developed regions will be in large cities. In developing regions, this share is likely to be only around 25%. It can be observed from Figure 7. Populations move to the cities with the aspiration of better lives. These aspirations are not only based upon better employment opportunities, but also better access to education and health facilities. Many of the cities in the developing world are becoming more prosperous, reflecting very significant progress on health and education. These cities have shown higher values of Human Development Index than the national averages. Cities with high Human Development Index values appear both as engines for positive change and as beneficiaries of prosperity. In the developing world, some urban areas are becoming so prosperous that they have closed the gap with or even surpassed the Human Development Index of cities in developed nations. For example, Seoul, South Korea, features a Human Development Index as high as 0.911, higher than that of many European cities, particularly the southern and eastern regions, where Human Development Index readings, though high, come under 0.900 in cities such as Lisbon, Athens, or Warsaw. Cities and quality of life of population. Today, no one disputes that quality of life is essential for a city to prosper. The notion is increasingly used by decision makers, practitioners, and urban populations alike. Recently, efforts have turned from definition of scientific measurement of quality of life. To Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, quality of life is determined by the various opportunities open to individuals and their freedom to choose from these many opportunities. Other conceptual approaches measure quality of life based on the notion of subjective well-being and on economic notions drawn from welfare economics. The most comprehensive subjective measurement of quality of life is the World Value Survey, which reflects representative individuals' beliefs and values in 54 countries around the world. The UN Habitat, in its City Prosperity Index, has given prime importance to quality of life of the population residing in the cities. The quality of life indicators developed in this index include health and education and various infrastructure indicators. Quality of life underpins the functionality of the cities. The notion is at the crossroads of all policies and actions, and a synthesis of all the dimensions of prosperity. When a city generates employment and economic growth, quality of life improves. When a city designs better buildings and public spaces that provide attractive, secure, clean, and durable surroundings, it is improving quality of life. When a city provides adequate public transport, it improves quality of life for both users and non-users. When a city raises levels of education and provides good health care, it is ensuring quality of life for the foreseeable future. And when a city reduces the use of environmental resources and becomes more energy efficient, it also improves quality of life. According to the UN Habitat Survey 2011, experts value security to live and work freely, good quality of education, adequate housing with basic services, and meaningful employment and decent income as the most important factors promoting quality of life and prosperity in their cities. It is being felt that the three most important issues for the city are educational facilities, job creation or reduction in unemployment, and the increased availability and quality of health services, among seven other alternatives such as social services, housing conditions, air pollution, noise, public transport, infrastructure, and safety. Thus, the experts and residents in developing and developed countries alike perceive that the quality of urban life is a broader concept that includes a full range of factors such as economic development, living standards, material progress, and individual and collective well-being, which all are important dimensions of prosperity. In the prosperity of a city, the economic growth and economic infrastructure, of course, plays an important role. But the quality of life of the population of the cities is no less important. This has been shown in Figure 9. Slum population and growth of cities. While we discuss about quality of life, the availability and quality of houses is the most important aspect. All other aspects of health and education are mainly determined by the living conditions. While we have discussed about increase in housing demand in top 600 cities, the conditions are miserable for those living in small cities and the poor population in the mega cities. As the cities grow and population growth outweighs the capacity of the city to provide decent housing, the growth of slums naturally takes place. Here, it is important to clarify that a slum area is characterized by five deprivations. These are lack of access to improved water, lack of access to sanitation, non-durable housing, insufficient living area, and security of tenure. The number of deprivations faced by the urban populations would show the severity of the deplorable housing conditions. A slum household can be categorized as moderately deprived or one shelter deprivation, severely deprived or two shelter deprivations, and extremely deprived or three or more shelter deprivations. For showing these deprivations, though we have data for all the developing regions, but to start with here, we shall concentrate on Asian cities. Slum concentrations throughout Asia vary widely, from an average of 43% in Southern Asia and 37% in Eastern Asia to 24% in Western Asia and 28% in Southeastern Asia. The high concentration of slum households in Southern Asia can be associated with a variety of factors, including lack of investment in the sub-region's housing sector, poverty, and instability. If we look at the table 1, which shows the highest and the lowest prevalence of slum population in Asia, we can observe that the countries of Laos, PGR, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Mongolia had the highest prevalence of slum population in their cities, while Thailand, Malaysia, and China had the least prevalence, with Singapore and Democratic Republic of Korea having negligible proportion of their populations living in slum conditions. Further, we can also look at the severity of living conditions in the slums by the number of deprivations in figure 10. The figure shows that in countries with high concentration of slum households, many suffer from multiple shelter deprivations, as we can see from the figure that in Laos PGR, 35.2% suffer from SWIR, that is two deprivations, and another 13.2% suffer from extreme, that is three or more deprivations. Similarly, in Bangladesh, 29.7% urban households suffer from SWIR and 13.6% suffer from extreme shelter deprivations. This further indicates that for many developing economies, the growth of cities may not always bring positive changes. However, the prevalence of slum population is not similar across whole of the developing regions. It may vary from region to region, country to country, and according to the size of the city. In some of the countries, the proportion of slum population is similar in small as well as large cities, while in some countries, the proportion of slum population is higher in small cities than the large cities. And in some cities, the reverse trends can also be found. Part A of the figure 11 shows that the countries such as Central African Republic, Chad, Ethiopia, Haiti, Yemen, etc. have same proportion of the population living under slum conditions in small as well as large cities. While part B of this figure shows that in Benin, Mozambique, Rwanda, Nepal, etc., relatively lower proportion of population lives in slums in large cities as compared to the small cities. In case of these countries, the proportion of slum population falls with increase in size of the city. In part C of figure 11, we can see that in Egypt, Ghana, Morocco, Brazil, etc., in small cities, a very low proportion of the population lives under slum conditions. But still, in most of the cases, it is higher than that of the large cities. Actually, these are the countries where the proportion of slum population is also lower in overall terms. Thus, we have observed that no single generalization fits slum neighborhoods. They are as diverse as cities themselves. However, it is clear that expanding urban infrastructure to underserviced or informal settlements is essential for improving the lives of slum dwellers. For this purpose, it is important to understand the location and severity of the problem. So, the more of the people can share the prosperity resulting from growth of the cities. Let us come to the conclusion of this lecture. In short, it can be stated that the world population is rapidly moving to the cities with hopes of a better life. This movement is taking place at a faster pace in the emerging economies whose cities are not yet well equipped to managing this ever increasing irreversible inflow of population. Therefore, the population in cities may face both the positive and negative aspects of urbanization. With urbanization, the composition of population, the household size, the type of household, as well as the demand for housing changes, which poses new challenges to the cities. The cities may increase the level of human capital and quality of life, but they also may push the population in poor living conditions of the slums under the circumstances of inadequacy of houses and inefficient urban management. Whole of this discussion points out the weak aspects as well as the strengths of the growth of the cities. For inclusive growth or harmonious and sustainable growth of the cities, the urban governance should aim to minimize the negative aspects while maximizing the positive ones. The growth of the cities will be positive only if it would be covering most of the residents of urban areas. I hope you must have enjoyed this lecture. Next time, we'll discuss another topic. Till then, have a nice time. Thank you.